To another episode of Calling Old Hollywood. I'm your host, Kat Lively, and our guest today is Steve Stolier. Hello, Steve.
Hi, how you doing, Kat?
Fantastic. Thank you so much for taking the time to be on the podcast today.
So am I, because you called me, am I old Hollywood?
No, it's just the focus on me. Just the focus on the, I did an interview the other day with Constance Towers, the actress. And she did, films with John Wayne. And that was immediately,
sure.
As soon as we started, she said, old? I'm not old.
Yeah.
I said, no. Yeah. So what haven't you done? You've done some pretty incredible things.
I haven't given birth to a child.
There's that.
Speaking of old Hollywood,
yes.
Did you know that Mae West was supposed to be on the cover of Sgt. Pepper and that big group shot of all the photos? And she wouldn't give permission because she said, what would I be doing with a lonely hearts club?
Wow.
So she missed out on being part of that landmark thing because she took it seriously the same way that people think, well, if it says old Hollywood, that must mean I have one foot in the grave.
Yes. But, man, she missed out. That is a cool cover.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, it is now an iconic piece of pop culture, mm-hmm. but she took it personally.
Yeah.
I did get to meet her, by the way, at Groucho Marx's house, which is striking to hear me utter those words, but mm-hmm. I met Mae West at Groucho Marx's house.
What a time.
How many people can make that statement?
Absolutely. No kidding. That is such a big thing I want to get to is the book. I mean, you've written for Dick Cavett. You wrote the
mm-hmm.
book on Groucho Marx after spending, time with him towards the end of his life. You've written and produced documentaries on John Lennon, Elvis Presley. You've done voiceover. You've done so many, many things. That's what I'm so excited about. And a lot of things that I just absolutely love. I know before we booked the podcast, we were talking a little bit. I'm going, wow, the Marx Brothers and Dick Cavett and, all of that.
That's Woody Allen.
Yes, exactly. Woody Allen.
Right.
Which is definitely one of my questions. I just, a dear, dear, dear one to me recommended this documentary the other night called By the Way, Woody Allen is Innocent. And
yes.
Holy, I already knew that, but when you really sit down, and that's like a 2.5 hour documentary, when you really sit down and watch it and you look at the facts, and it's mind-boggling how people could think in the
end. He really did his homework, the guy that put that together, and I'm glad he did that, because the evidence of Woody's innocence is overwhelming, but it's sort of been scattered out there. Mm-hmm. It's like I would send people links to this op-ed and this report and this thing, but no one had bothered to collate it and put it all together and say, let me show you why you must not rush to judgment in this case.
Yes.
And I run into people who say, well, I try to separate the artist from the work, and it's like, no. You can do that if you want with Roman Polanski. You could say, I love Chinatown, but what he did was terrible. Mm-hmm. But you don't need to give Woody Allen that break because there's nothing to look past or forgive him for.
Mm-hmm.
And it's too bad that in this age of scrolling through Twitter feeds, there can be one story that takes off, and people that look at that and say, oh, well, that must be the truth. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, you can't expect everyone to dig beneath the surface and research it and look at the reports from doctors and judges and clinics and all this stuff. And it's easier to just throw him in with the woke Me Too thing and say, oh, I guess he's a horrible person. I didn't realize that. He must be like Bill Cosby. Those funny guys are all sick. Mm-hmm. And it just isn't the case. As I think I mentioned last time you and I spoke, for the people who are tempted to say, oh, sure, well, you're a guy, and you guys stick together and stick up for each other, and that's what allows predators to seek out victims. Mm-hmm. My late wife had been the victim of severe sexual abuse from her father and brother when she was a child and adolescent, mm-hmm. and I got to see firsthand over a period of years what the horrific effects of that are on an adult woman. And she knew, after carefully going over it, she came to the same conclusion that Woody was innocent. And if anyone could have been forgiven for taking the side of an accusing child, it would have been my wife. But even she knew that it was the vengeance of Mia Farrow and her,
of course.
I think, what did Dick Cavett call it, her psychotic, psychotically vengeful personality, mm-hmm. that has orchestrated this thing. And then Ronan Farrow gone around to each of the people that were in Woody's movies and said, if you don't publicly denounce him, I will spread the word that you support child molester. And it's easier to cave than to fight a battle like that. So anyway, I'll hop down off my soapbox and let you ask me something else.
It was definitely something that I wanted to talk about as well, though, because it is. It's I love Woody Allen films. You know, I mean, all of that, mm-hmm. and that's why it is. It's one of those things where it's. Just, it's so unfortunate. I feel like, you know, he's dealt with it very well, you know, and very, very professionally.
Yeah.
But Jesus, Mia Farrow. I just can't, you know.
She's sort of crazy, but she has the image of being this wonderful, generous, I mean, oh my God, she took in all these poor, broken, abandoned children and shared her wealth with them. Isn't that wonderful? But then you read firsthand accounts from her adopted son Moses and from Sun Yi, where they talk about how physically and mentally and emotionally abusive she was. That she tended to beat. What'd you say?
Some of the kids that she adopted had killed themselves. You know.
Yeah, there are three of them have died. By their own hand, actually, and she favors the white ones and treats the off-white ones as servants to be broken and to serve the other ones, and it's too bad that doesn't get as much press. Mm-hmm. As that Woody Allen must be a monster, and so don't let him make an...
It's one of those things, like, when I first learned about Mia Farrow, it was in regards to, you know, obviously Rosemary's Baby, but also after that, it was the whole thing with Frank Sinatra and how he served her pictures on the set of Rosemary's Baby. And so you kind of feel bad, you know, oh, that was kind of a dick thing for Sinatra to do. But then, you know, it's like there's this whole other thing that's going on with her, you know, with the Woody Allen thing and just her as a person and how completely unhinged mommy dearest, you know,
right.
kind of thing going on. So I'm glad that
she ruled with an iron fist. But yes, Woody is remarkably resilient. Mm-hmm. And I got a letter from him recently, and he said, take heart, I'm working on a vaccine for the coronavirus, and I think a little more cinnamon and I'll have it. So he just keeps going. And I end up, I think, sometimes getting more upset than he does about this injustice, because he's continuing to make movies.
Right.
He gets financing from overseas. There are still, you know, very talented performers who want to work with him. And he tends to make most of his money from overseas releases anyway. He said it's never been a case where the domestic gross is the biggest part of his winnings. And the rest of the world doesn't have this problem that America does. So, you know, he's very happy at this point in his life. He has a wife who is now, you know, late middle age. They've been married for 25 or so years. And they adopted two little girls, which is another point that people tend to sweep under the rug, which is what adoption agency would allow him to adopt two young girls if there was any chance they were going to be at peril.
Yeah.
So they're now like college age, which is amazing. But he's very content, and he has money, and he makes movies, and he writes. He wrote a play. He wrote his memoir that came out a few months ago. He plays his clarinet. So if living well is the best revenge, you know, he still wins, because they haven't really stopped him. Although it is unfortunate that they, you know, made a substantial dent in his image and legacy, but he doesn't seem to care much about that.
Right. So. Right. He knows the truth, and anybody with, you know, 10 minutes of research, you know, can figure out that there's so much more.
Yeah.
And especially the documentary.
Yes.
I mean, like I said, I had already.
It's on YouTube.
Yeah. Like I said, I already, you know, had my opinion, and that was that he was innocent. But that the documentary really, for the listeners, you can find the documentary for free on YouTube. It's called By the Way, Woody Allen is Innocent, and it will blow your mind. You know. So
there's also the people who think, oh, but he married his daughter. He married his adoptive daughter. Mm-hmm. He married an underage. And it's like all those things aren't true. Yes. He was never in a paternal role. It was always Andre Previn. I mean, Woody is able to compartmentalize. He never even spent the night at Mia Farrow's place. Mm-hmm. So the people who think that, you know, he was a predator that groomed Sun Yi, she credits him with saving her life, literally saving her life, because she's convinced if she hadn't been rescued from the Pharaoh compound, she would probably not be around today for, you know, one of several reasons.
Right.
So he rescued her. He did not prey upon her.
And
as I say, it's a quarter of a century that they've been married.
That in itself, just that in itself, yeah, there's a significant age difference, but who cares? You know, if people connect, they connect. Yeah. And all these years, like you just said, later, and they're still together. You know, it just proves so many things invalid with certain opinions, you know?
Right.
The truth is there. The truth is there. All right. Let's, getting back to you. So you've written these books, documentaries, different things for film and television. So how did this all begin for you? Were you very young when you first began writing, or did it come later?
Actually, you know, in school, I seemed to have a flair for it. I remember winning a ribbon in junior high for some short story I wrote. And I wrote jokes and sent them in to laugh in. And I got a letter back from the head writer that said, you obviously have an ear for humor and should be encouraged to keep at it, which meant a lot to me. It was also very shortly after my mom died, and it was a horrible time for me. And to get this letter from the head writer of Laugh-In, which at the time was just the last word in cutting-edge comedy on television, was very encouraging. And in college, I was a history major because I've always and still have a passion for archaeology and paleontology. And I didn't really think you could make a living in entertainment, even though I loved old movies and old comedies, and especially the Marx Brothers, and of the Marx Brothers, especially Groucho. Mm-hmm. And I sure wanted to meet him, but I knew that there wasn't much of a chance of that because he was in his 80s and in frail health, and what would be the circumstances under which our paths would cross. And it was so frustrating. I would hear about him being spotted on the street taking a walk, and I'd think, do I stake it out? Do I just stalk this man? I remember my college roommate and I ate at Jacopo's Pizzeria, which used to be in Beverly Hills, because someone told us he would eat there, like he's going to be there that moment. Mm-hmm. And so the waitress came by and I said, does Groucho Marx really eat here? And she said, oh, yes. As a matter of fact, he was in yesterday. He always comes in after we open and tries to pay with a $100 bill, and he knows we can't make change. He's so funny. And I just wanted to stick a fork in her throat. Like, don't waste his appearances on this waitress. I want to meet Groucho. But I didn't think there was much of a chance. And when I was at UCLA as a history major, I started a committee to put pressure on Universal Studios to re-release Animal Crackers, which was the Marx Brothers' second film.
Of course, yeah.
And it hadn't been seen in decades because the copyright had lapsed and reverted back to the composers and writers of the original Broadway play. And even though the film had been made at Paramount, and then the old Paramount films were bought by Universal, but they didn't have the right to release it. And they didn't think there was any point in putting money in an old black and white movie, because this is long before TCM and DVDs and streaming and all that. And to them, it was just some old movie that who cares, and why would you throw good money to have this creaky old black and white movie. But all my friends were fanatic Marx Brothers nuts.
Mm-hmm. Your friends and had good taste. Your friends had good taste.
I what?
I said your friends had good taste.
Oh, yes. It was a prerequisite. If they didn't like the Marx Brothers, I shot them out of a cannon. So I started this committee at UCLA to put pressure on Universal, and I got in touch with Aaron Fleming, who was the young, ambitious, controversial woman who had become, she had started out as Groucho's secretary and became his manager, and really, as he got weaker, she became more powerful as he relied on her more. And she arranged for Groucho to come to campus and for news people to be there, and we had hundreds of students crowding around us. And we sat there and next to each other and talked to the press about Animal Crackers. I said, Groucho, I am very happy to be meeting you after all this time. And he said, well, you should be. And Aaron said, Steve is the one who's trying to get Animal Crackers re-released. And Groucho said, well, did you get it? And I said, not yet, but we're working on it. And he said, well, you better or I'll fire you. And I said, I didn't even realize I was working for you. How much are you paying me? And he said, a little less than nothing. And it's like, I couldn't believe I'm sitting there exchanging pleasantries with my hero. And they ended up, Universal relented and released the film. And it broke the box office record at the UA Westwood that had been set by the French Connection. Wow. And it was great to go down there and see a line around the block of all these college students who had also been waiting to see this movie. Right. And that summer in 74, I had two summer jobs fall through, for which I remain eternally grateful, because my dad was yelling at me, get off your fanny. I don't want you spending the summer just sitting around. Go get a job somewhere. See if they need someone at Taco Bell or something. And I thought, I have nothing to lose. So I called Aaron Fleming and I said, is there anything at all that you think I could possibly? And she said, well, actually, I used to be Groucho's secretary, but I'm his manager now. And there's so much fan mail that comes in that needs to be handled. Plus, we need someone who really knows their Marx Brothers to put all of Groucho's memorabilia in order, which will be later donated to the Smithsonian. And I thought, please, 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 please. And in my mind's eye, it's like I'm on the doorstep of their house while she's still on the phone explaining the job to me, like a cartoon or something. Yeah. But it wasn't quite like
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely.
But I did. I got to work at I thought it would be in an office building. She said, oh, no, dear, there's a room here you can use and you can make your own hours. And they were paying me money to go in and, like, wade ankle deep in Marx Brothers memorabilia with posters and letters and scrapbooks from vaudeville and Broadway, and also getting to sit at the lunch table with my hero in a relaxed atmosphere and talk to him about his brothers and the old days. And he would have people like George Burns and Jack Lemmon and Steve Allen and Hal Cantor and come in and have lunch with him, and I was always welcome to join them. I didn't have to eat in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. I was treated well, and it was just this. And it turned into a 3-year stint, the last 3 years of his life.
And how old were you at this time?
Mm-hmm.
How old were you?
I was 19 when I got the job.
It just had to have blown your mind.
It did, because it so far exceeded. I mean, I'll describe the job to people as a dream come true, but in my case, it's not. It was literal, because I was so obsessed with Groucho that I would dream about him, and then I would wake up, and as I would wake up, the image would start disappearing, and I would think, damn, it was so vivid. I was sure. I remember one dream where I was walking down the street and I saw Groucho and I said, oh, Mr. Marx, would it be at all possible? Do you think, is it? And he reached into his jacket pocket and handed me a cigar. And I said, how did you know? And then I woke up and cursed the gods.
Right.
So, yeah, one of the best compliments I get these days is, I hate you. Because I would hate me too if I'd been as big a Marx Brothers fan as me and someone else got this amazing opportunity.
Yes, of course.
And plus he didn't have the most famous brothers still alive. Chico and Harpo died in the early 60s, but Zeppo, the straight man from the movies, was still around, and Gummo, who left the act in World War I, was still around. Mm-hmm. So I got to meet 3 out of 5 of the Marx Brothers. And as a matter of fact, Zeppo and I dated the same girl at one point.
Amazing.
She was 19, I was 20, and he was 74.
Wonderful.
And was quite smitten with her when I brought her to dinner there once. And then when she and I broke up, I had a couple pictures of him that I wanted him to sign. So I sent them to him in Palm Springs with a cover letter saying, well, Linda and I broke up. If you have any advice for the lovelorn, I know you've been around the block a few times. And he calls long distance from Palm Springs, Steve, is Zeppo Mark. So listen, I got your letter and the photos. God, I was good looking back then. And I don't want to step on your toes. You understand, and that's the last thing I'd want, but do you think that Linda would go out with me? And I thought, this is really weird. I'm asking him for advice and he's hitting. I said, well, I think, you know, she got a kick out of you. I'll have to, because if it's any problem, if you're at all uncomfortable, no, 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 no. So I talked to her and she kind of got a kick out of it too. And they went out once. He took her to dinner in San Diego and then to attend a Hialeah game in Tijuana. Mm-hmm. And he said, "Steve, I want to tell you, I didn't even kiss a goodnight, so you don't have to worry about that. She's very nice, but all she did was talk about herself."
Yeah.
"And then I met her on campus, and she said, 'Zeppa was very nice, but all he did was talk about himself.' And I thought, gee, what a perfect couple." But I now have the distinction of saying that Zeppa Marx and I did. You know, his ex-wife ended up marrying Frank Sinatra down in Palm Springs. So, yeah, she dumped Zeppo and traded up for Sinatra.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was just an amazing, you know, the downside was watching my hero fading slowly and putting up with the mercurial temperament of Aaron Fleming, who was quite unhinged, but he was quite dependent on her. So, yes, at 19 and 20 years old, I was having to deal with some very volatile personalities, and I was not used to that at all. I didn't grow up in a house where there was screaming or, you know, mental problems. But Aaron, she would carefully build bridges and then burn them. Mm-hmm. And just a very difficult woman. But my interest was in being there for Groucho, and I didn't want this ride to end, even if some of it was very stressful. And so I ended up being there for, you know, what turned out to be the last 3 years of his life, from 74 to 77.
Yeah.
And that really, that lit the fuse for me to pursue it. I switched from history to motion picture television at UCLA, and then began writing, and I ended up working at Universal in the Steno pool for a while, typing up Kojaks and Rockford Files and Berettas till 8 o'clock each night. Mm-hmm. And then Dick Cavett, who I had become a correspondent with because of Groucho's, hired me to go to New York and write for him.
Which is amazing.
It was really cool. He and I had become correspondents because I was a pipeline into Groucho's house. And then when Groucho died, I thought, well, I guess that's the last I'll hear from Cavett, because I can't share any more gossip with him.
He called me
from New York, and he said, "Listen, I hope just because Groucho's gone, we're not going to lose touch. And by the way, I've shown some of your letters to Woody. I hope you don't mind, but he says they're very well written." And I sort of emptied the urine out of my shoes with that 1-2 punch. Yeah. And he was sort of a big brother to me, not in an Orwellian sense. Mm-hmm. I made the big break from being a secretary to being a writer for Cavett. And then when that ended, I moved back to L.A. because I got another gig. I didn't want to move back. I loved Manhattan.
Manhattan's wonderful.
Just drank it in. And it was, I mean, I got to meet so many great people because of Cavett. And
it's a hell of a ride. When, going back to Groucho for just a second, what was it like for you when he did finally die? Because, you know, I mean, when you... essentially lifelong love and admiration for this person.
Yeah.
And then it really was full circle. You know, did you ever tell him about the dreams or any of that, like those vivid things that you experienced?
Yeah. And I sort of felt like I was the official representative of the people out there in the dark.
Mm-hmm.
And I know once I came from, he made a point of signing stacks of photos that I would send out to fans. He didn't have me forge his name. I would write the personalizations, like to Joey, happy birthday, but he would always sign Groucho on the photos,
mm-hmm.
which was, you know, I thought pretty cool for someone in his 80s and in failing health to bother doing that. And I turned around one day and I said to him, "By the way, Groucho, on behalf of all the fans, thank you for bothering to do this." Mm-hmm. And he said, "Well, I consider it part of my job,"
yeah.
which was awfully nice of him. I don't remember what your question was.
Oh, it's
was
okay. Just how you dealt, you know, when he finally...
Well, there had been so many false alarms.
Yeah.
I mean, I think my third week there, I was finally getting comfortable and not waiting for someone to grab me by the scruff of the neck and say, we've made a terrible mistake, get out of here.
Yeah.
And I rang the bell, and the maid answered and said, please be quiet, Mr. Marx has had a stroke. And I thought, oh, God, this is it. It lasted 3 weeks. He's gone. The coach is turning back into a pumpkin.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, the nurse asked to see you. So I went in the back expecting to see him lying on the floor or on his bed, barely. And then he was propped up in bed with his beret and his mucklucks, reading the paper, and he said, is the ambulance here yet? I said, not yet. It figures. And he was like taking it in stride. It ended up being a very minor stroke, if there is such a thing. Or a mini stroke, I guess. Anyway, it was just still the beginning of my stint there. But I had watched him slowly, like a clock winding down with different health problems. So that by the time he really did shuffle off this mortal coil, as Bill Shakespeare told me once, it was, I don't know if you've ever had an elderly relative who had been in ill health.
Yes.
But it's that strange blend of sadness and acceptance and relief that the struggle's over.
Yeah.
You know, absolutely. It was very significant for me because I knew this chunk of my life was ending, that they would no longer need someone to handle fan mail for someone who isn't around anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So I was very sad the night I got the news on the radio. I was expecting it because I was in touch with his grandson and nurses, and I knew that this was probably it.
Right.
While he was at Cedars-Sinai. Mm-hmm. And even then, as hazy as he had gotten, drifting in and out of lucidity, his grandson told me this. He was standing there, and the nurse came in, and Groucho had been asleep, and he opened his eyes. He said, what do you want? And she said, I want to see if you have a temperature. And he said, don't be silly. Everyone has a temperature. And he went back to sleep. So even at death's door, banging on it with both fists, he still had traces of that wordplay where you'd hand him something and he'd twist it and hand it back to you.
Yeah.
So I remain very grateful for that period in my life, which continues to inform it now. Mm-hmm. I wrote a book called Raised Eyebrows, My Years Inside Groucho's House.
Yes.
That came out in the 90s, and then I did an update with an extra chapter on what's happened to me and the people that I wrote about since the original edition came out.
Mm-hmm.
And Dick Cavett wrote the introduction, and I got blurbs from Jack Lemmon and Steve Allen, and Woody Allen said it was one of the best books about a show business icon he'd ever read, which blew me away.
Incredible.
And now it is in development as a motion picture.
Yes, this is so exciting too. When you were writing it, did you at all see it as a film, or did you even think about it?
It did occur to me that there were elements of, like, my favorite year and even, like, Sunset Boulevard. Mm-hmm. And then after the book came out, when I would see something like Ed Wood or Marilyn and Me or the Gods and Monsters, where there would be some young impressionable person and then an aging legend, it kept reinforcing the idea that there was something here, that it was not a biography of Groucho. It's a story of this kid dropped into this petri dish with giant forceps,
mm-hmm.
where there's his hero who's fading and this ambitious, volatile woman that he's having to juggle at the same time.
Right.
And that was a pretty strong premise. Then I had to put up with producers who said, I really enjoyed your book, but if you think there's a movie here, you're mistaken. You could use it maybe to bookend Groucho's story. And I thought, well, I see I'm going to have to climb up the tree with a hacksaw and cut off the branches that aren't part of the movie so people can see it.
Yeah.
And I wrote the initial draft of the screenplay, and then they went, oh, I see, yes. Okay. And so that's where it is. And it was, I mean, the COVID thing has put a temporary moratorium on moving forward, but I recently found out that they're going to restart the gears.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't really talk about who's involved with it, but we have a director, and I'm still the co-writer of the script, and we may have a Groucho lined up that I, again, can't talk about.
Yeah,
and then, of course, it's going to be surreal to see someone playing Steve Stolier at 20 on the screen, some kid with shaggy hair and mutton chops and a mustache.
If you had an ideal person that you could cast to play you, who would that be?
I don't know, because I'm not in touch with who's that young and making a mark in film or television. Mm-hmm. I mean, my peers will say to me, oh, you know who would be good? And they'll mention someone, and I'll say, you know, he's 38 now.
Yeah.
It's like you lose sight of the, I think Macaulay Culkin just turned 40.
Yep.
I don't know what I'm supposed to do with that information. That time whizzes by so fast, I feel sometimes like I should walk around with a seatbelt on.
Right.
So it's going to be someone, I mean, the director already has several young people in mind, and it's like he'll tell me the name, and then I'll look on YouTube and look on Wiki or IMDb. And that's sort of out of my hands, because there's no one that I'm really rooting for.
Right.
And then the Aaron Fleming character, I think, is a real plum part for an actress, because she seems to be this devoted, it's like, gee, when his family had turned their backs on him and he was divorced, he was just rattling around in this big house in Beverly Hills. And this youngish woman came along and devoted herself to him. Boy, I hope when I'm his age I have someone like that. And then you find out that she would scream and slam the door and drive him to tears and berate him.
Jeez.
And just, it was, you know, there was a whole Cruella de Vil side to her.
I could do without that. Yeah.
My lively cat is currently chasing his tail. I was just distracted by a swirling motion out of the corner of my eye, and I looked over, and a spinning blur that had been my cat, Oscar. So forgive me, my lively cat is doing that.
Yes.
So that's pretty exciting for me.
Yeah. I want to see
it
turned into a film. I can, you know, immediately see the potential in how wonderful a film this will be.
It will essentially be a drama. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be a bunch of laughs,
right?
Only, but it will certainly have humor and comedy in it because of Groucho and back and forth conversations and stuff. But it's essentially a drama, so. You know, people would suggest to me, oh, you know who does a good Groucho? And it's like, you don't understand. It's not an impression.
Right.
It has to be a sustained dramatic performance for the length of a film. Sort of like, I remember when I heard that Martin Landau was going to play the aging Lugosi in Ed Wood, and I thought, that's miscasting. He doesn't look like him. He doesn't. And wow, when I saw that, and I think he ended up winning Best Supporting Actor.
Yeah.
So you never know what people are capable of, and
that's
I
true.
Really look forward to seeing how this
and when
unfolds.
When they get into their characters, did you see Renee Zellweger as Judy? She played
Judy?
Judy Garland. She was in a...
Sorry.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't. I know I've seen clips from it. And I kind of have a problem when someone is playing someone at a time when they were super well known. I would have the same problem if someone were trying to be Groucho in the 30s with the mustache, or in the 50s on You Bet Your Life.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a tough audience, and there's than other biopics where people have said it's uncanny, it's like they've occupied the body, they've resurrected the person. Mm-hmm. And I haven't seen it. I guess I probably should, but I had a sort of built-in resistance.
It is a wonderful film, but if you don't like it, then you don't like it. But it was her, her performance was top notch, you know, but that's, you know, sometimes, you know, they say things like that. What was that film Jim Carrey did where he played Andy Kaufman?
Came pretty close. That was pretty good. And I thought that Downey's Chaplin back, that almost made you suspend disbelief that it was an actor playing him.
Right. I love
anyway,
when actors.
But I always think that if you can play someone famous before the period when they were most famous, mm-hmm. or after that period, it's easier for the audience to accept it because they're not constantly slamming into the real thing with all the footage that exists. There was a really good movie called, it was like Before the Rainbow, something like that.
Yeah.
Years ago, it was a TV movie, and Andrea McArdle played Judy Garland.
Yeah.
And I think it was directed by Jackie Cooper, who was his own.
So good.
Yeah, because you weren't butting up against the classic Judy Garland. She was just Frances Gum trying to get a break as a singer.
Yeah.
So if you play someone, or like Lugosi, Martin Landau, which, you know, he wasn't playing him in the 30s, and they had, you know, when there would be clips, vintage clips, it was because Johnny Depp and Landau were looking at actual clips, and that's, I think, what we would do in the film version of Raised Eyebrows, rather than trying to dress people up and make it look like the 30s, have them watching TV with a clip from the old film and have the Groucho guy say, I remember when we shot this, she was a wonderful actress. And I think that's the best way to do it, so you're not saying that looks kind of tacky,
mm-hmm.
but, you know, what they're watching. So
I like
anyway.
I like that take on it. We were talking to about Dick Cavett, another one that I just absolutely adore. And so I watched
Rerun. You have great taste.
Thank you.
I don't care what they say about you. You have great taste.
Thank you. It's so, I love watching the reruns, you know, especially hosting the podcast. You know, I'll sit there and I take notes. I go, oh, that was really great how he did that, you know.
Yeah.
There's just something.
Yeah, he had a great blend of intellectual and low comedy.
Mm-hmm.
And it rubs some people the wrong way. And that's how he is in real life. So if you like how he came off on his show, that is how he is.
Mm-hmm.
And in the case of his shows, they were conversations.
Right, exactly.
That went back and forth.
Yes.
And there's the people who say, why does he have to throw in his own stuff? And it's like, well, you know, when it was like Merv Griffin or Mike Douglas, I would agree with you. I want to hear the guest.
Mm-hmm.
But in Cavett's case, he was so well-read and had his own experience on the stage and literature and all this stuff, that he could make it a richer experience by adding to the conversation instead of just, you know, what was your first job and, you know, what's your favorite song?
He was he still is. I mean, he's still around. He was so diverse and able to carry on. You know, it was equals up there that you were watching, you know, no matter who it was.
And the thought of having, I mean, now with talk shows where people are on for 4 minutes and that's it, and it's more entertainment than talking,
mm-hmm.
You know, that he was able to do 90 minutes with Orson Welles or Katharine Hepburn,
Lauren Bacall,
or John Lennon. And no other guests to dilute the experience, mm-hmm. sometimes. Gone are the days and nights.
It's true. What was it like working on all of that with him?
Oh, we got along so great. I met him once when I visited New York after Groucho died, and they arranged. He was doing his PBS interview show,
mm-hmm.
and his secretary arranged for me to attend a taping. And then I was going to meet him afterwards. So I got to watch him interview several New Yorker cartoonists, including Charles Adams, and then a two-part with Gore Vidal. And then afterwards, I went back, and I was nervous for about 8 seconds, and then it was like we went to junior high together, and has been that way ever since. And I, there were so many times when we would just crack each other up and worry that our lungs weren't going to reinflate by the time we passed out, because we could just end up being little naughty boys saying things you're not supposed to say. There's a part of him that, you know, if it says do not enter, he'll check it out.
Yeah.
He told me, with, he said he went into someone's office once, and the door was closed to the person he was going to see. So he just walked up and grabbed the doorknob and started to enter. She said, you can't go in there. And he said, of course I can. You see, there's this rectangular hole that's been cut in the wall and these hinges that allow the door to swing. So, yeah, he's just a great guy, and he's been very supportive of me. He was very helpful when my wife died, because his wife had died a couple of years earlier. His first wife had died of lung cancer, and he emailed me and said, yours is worse because you had no chance to prepare.
Yeah.
And then, but he, because he would shoot from the hip. He wouldn't just deliver Hallmark fortune cookie pieces of advice. He would say, you know, friends will tell you it gets a little easier each day, and you may thank them, of course, but they are full of shit.
Yeah, no kidding.
That's so funny. Yeah, he's a great guy.
Sounds. If you had to, what's your favorite interview? Do you have one that he's done?
Oh boy, I can't. It's like someone saying what was the highlight of working for Groucho for 3 years?
Yeah.
It's picking snowflakes out of a blizzard. There's so many, and they're not even necessarily the most famous people, but I don't know. I mean, I guess the 1969 Groucho show, when Groucho was at his best and Cavett was still... Cavett never really lost that sense of, I'm this kid from Nebraska and they're paying me money to talk to Fred Astaire.
Yeah.
There, you know, people think that that was fake, that it was disingenuous. It's like, oh, come on, you went to Yale and you live in Manhattan. Don't give us this gosh and gee golly. But he always was... It's like, wow, it's Bob Hope. I can't believe it. The guy that we used to listen to
that.
On the radio.
Yeah, just that kind of boyish excitement about it. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
incredible. He never lost that.
Yeah. No, I love that. That's how I feel with the podcast too sometimes, where I have people on and I go, oh my gosh, you know, they did this or they did that. But it is, it's wonderful. It's wonderful getting to talk to, you know, either your heroes or people who knew them, or just, you know, because it's that, just that sage experience and culture and having a conversation.
And I've had good luck in not being disappointed, because, you know, there's the be careful what you wish for. It isn't a good idea to meet your heroes.
Right.
And even after Cavett had told me that Woody had read my letters to Cavett and said they're good, I was hesitant to meet him, especially after Stardust Memories, because I felt like he had contempt for anyone that admires him. And I thought, there's nothing I can really say that's going to make, you know, he doesn't suffer fools gladly and blah, blah, blah. And he and Cavett had been friends since the early 60s, when Dick worked as a talent, or as a writer on the Tonight Show. And they were good buddies, and Dick would say, you know, no, Woody and I were walking through Central Park yesterday, and I never wanted to say, can I go too? Because I really felt like it would be this, beat it, kid, you're not in our league.
Right.
And one day, I got a call from Cavett, and he said, listen, I noticed that Woody is shooting his film just around the corner from my apartment. So I thought you could come over and we could just happen to stop by and then you could meet him. And I said, and he won't mind? And he said, Oh, I didn't say that. I mean, he may very well say, really, Dickie, I wish you hadn't. Mm-hmm. And I thought, that's great. I'm nervous about meeting him. And you tell me he may be very upset. But we did it anyway. And it was a medical building. And this sounds like I'm enhancing it for dramatic purposes. But we went up on this elevator and the doors opened and there was a long hallway. And at the end of the hallway was an open door with a very bright light emanating from it. Mm-hmm. Like the Wizard of Oz, because that was the room that Woody was shooting in. Mm-hmm. And Cavett said, let me check this out, and you stay here. So I stayed at the end of the hall, and he went up, and he's looking in the room where the light... Then the light went off, and Woody Allen and Mia Farrow came out. And it was Hannah and her sisters, mm-hmm. and it was the scene where they go to see the doctor and learn they can't have children, and Woody's wearing a bowling shirt. So I see the three of them talking, and I'm thinking, wow, it's Dick Cavett and Mia Farrow and Woody Allen. This is really neat. Yeah. And then I see Cavett point to me, and they look, they turn their heads, and I did that thing where you go, like, look behind you and go, me?
Right.
And I walk down the hall, and Woody Allen said, I'm Woody Allen, and this is Miss Farrow, and we're here on the set of our latest picture. Sort of like an Entertainment Tonight introduction. Mm-hmm. And then after that, it was a very comfortable conversation amongst the four of us. I wasn't intimidated. I listened a lot. He already knew I was okay because of Cavett, but it ended up being okay. And then when I moved back to L.A., I sent him a letter, and we started this correspondence that continues. Mm-hmm. And the letters are wonderful. And then when he was doing Cafe Society, he said, feel free to drop by the set and watch how not to make a movie.
Yeah.
And I got to spend a few days up close. He would have me sit in the director's chair, and he would explain what he's trying to do with each shot and how it fits in. And Handy, he says, if you're ever directing a comedy, always do one more take where they read the dialogue quicker, because I'm in the editing room and I'm always looking for a take, but it always seems too slow. So if you're ever directing a comedy, always do one take you think is too fast, because that's the one you'll use. Mm-hmm. It was just this amazing experience.
That's wonderful.
So he's a bud.
And that's... I love that film too, Cafe Society. The apartment the guy lives on are the same cross streets that I live on with Grace and Yucca. It's like, that's really interesting.
Where who lives?
Oh, in the film, that this character, it stuck out to me because the character in the film, he lives on Grace and Yucca, and those are the cross streets that I live on.
It's like in Sunset Boulevard where William Holden talks about the Altolito apartments on Fountain and something, and it's still there. You can just go past that shot now.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, that is neat when it's like, hey, I know where that is. Mm-hmm. They shot, the scenes that I saw shot were done, one of them was at a magnificent 1920s Los Feliz mansion, mm-hmm. Spanish style, and the other was in Santa Monica. It was used in the opening shot at the party scene around the pool, and that was Dolores Del Rio's house that was designed by her then-husband, Cedric Gibbons, who was in charge of set design at MGM. And it's just this perfect deco palace, and it was so cool to be there to watch them shoot this, but also to think, wow, they lived here. I mean, I've seen pictures of Gary Cooper swimming in Dolores Del Rio's pool, and I would look at the pool and go, Gary Cooper swam there in 1932.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
That's what my mind does.
I'm the same way with the iconic, the history and the landmarks and.
Yes, this happened at this spot.
Yeah, yes. I'm such a nerd for that kind of stuff. I live, you know.
Good. Don't change.
Yeah, I live for it, you know. I just recently started doing a weekly YouTube video series to coincide with the podcast, where I'm going around to old Hollywood locations and basically saying, this is where this happened, or this is where this happened.
Yeah.
And,
I love it when someone bothers to... I have a friend, Mary Mallory, who has an encyclopedic knowledge of locations, and she'll be able to identify, you know, in a Chaplin short, she'll say, that's Western and Pico.
Wow.
Because of the way the hill curves, or because of that tree or something. And it's always really cool when you see those side-by-side pictures, and you realize that this building has been modified, but look, there's the doorway. They didn't demolish the doorway. That's the same one those people walked in.
Right.
Yeah, so it's cool that you're doing the YouTube thing, because it is great, especially if you're able to get any images from then and say, you see, it's still the same tree. There's the same tree, just taller.
And there's so many, too. You know, there's so many, like, speaking of Chaplin, outside the Jim Henson Studios, you know, all of that is things with him standing on the steps and, you know,
the Laurel and Hardy steps, too.
Yeah.
Or,
yes, absolutely. Yeah, the music box steps over in Echo Park. Yeah, Echo Park, Lake area.
Yeah, very good.
Yeah, I've been there. What else? What was I going to say? In New York, when I lived in New York, I lived in...
Where'd you live?
James Dean's former apartment.
Well, he didn't need it anymore. Where was that?
Former at that point. No, that was just last year. I was on the Upper West Side on 68th and Central Park West. So
I was at 19 West 82nd between Central Park West and Columbus.
Okay, yeah, I know. So yeah, right in that neighborhood.
The old Brown.
I was about, was it four blocks up from the Dakota, where John Lennon, and Yoko, and I mean several other, you know, Lauren Bacall lived there till she died. All
right.
But
I met her on the set of the Rockford Files.
Really?
What was of that all like? The unlikely things. Well, that was what was cool about working in the Steno Pool at Universal. I didn't care about the then current shows. I didn't care about seeing Lindsay Wagner from Bionic Woman. Mm-hmm. But they would have guest stars, and those would be the people that would intrigue me.
Yes.
I mean, I got Tom Yule's autograph on a photo from 7 Year Itch because he was on Beretta.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw that Lauren Bacall was going to be guest starring in a 2-part Rockford Files, which I think she won an Emmy for. So I got an original still of her from about 1945. And on my lunch hour, I sauntered over to the soundstage. And it was between shots, and she was talking to Jim Garner.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't care that much about James Garner, but there was Lauren Bacall.
Yeah.
And I waited for a break in their conversation. And I asked if she would sign the pictures, and she looked at it, and she said, oh, that was at Warner Brothers. And I said, I have a question. How familiar are you with Key Largo?
Me, personally? The film?
Yes.
Yeah.
Have you seen it?
Yeah, of course.
I don't know.
Oh, no, sorry.
Well, for those who haven't seen it, there's a scene in Key Largo where Edward G. Robinson, who is a gangster, whispers something lascivious into Lauren Bacall's ear, and she spits in his face. Mm-hmm. And you can't hear what he's saying. You just see him whispering. So what I said to her was, I've always wondered, I know what Robinson's character, what the sort of thing was that he probably would have been whispering about. But could I ask you what it was that Robinson, the actor, was actually whispering? Mm-hmm. And she looked me in the eye and said, well, you can ask. And I said, okay, well, thank you very much.
Yes.
It was a gentle brush off.
She was so.
Can I ask you what it is? Well, you can ask, but I'm not going to tell you, was the inference. So that was my rendezvous with Miss Persky.
Gosh, she was incredible. That's I would have loved to have met her. You know, her and Bogey, to, you know, all their films together. But everything.
Oh yeah.
Jesus. You know.
I'm currently. This is a labor of love that I think a lot of people will find it interesting as well. I'm the baby in the family. My dad was in World War II, and when he was overseas fighting the Nazis, mm-hmm. he made a point of writing my mother every day, just about, and often several pages. Mm-hmm. So I have hundreds of letters
wow.
that show just what it was like to be a GI in World War II and all the things that were on his mind, all of his experiences. It's a remarkable time capsule. So I'm in the midst of retyping them, and then we'll edit them down into book length because I think it's a real time
That's
capsule.
Incredible.
But what's really cool is he would be talking about what's current, what he and mom would talk about, what's currently on the hit parade. He would say, like, I haven't heard Swinging on a Star yet. I know it's number one. I finally heard it. I didn't think much of it. And Rum and Coca-Cola. And then he'll give his little thumbnail reviews of movies because mm-hmm. he and mom always went to the movies. It was a big part of their dating and their leisure life. And they would compare notes back and forth in the middle of a world war. Well, I finally saw that movie you recommended and I didn't think much of it. But and of course, you're thinking to yourself, what was just coming out in 44? What was just coming out? So he says, I saw a movie called To Have and Have Not.
Mm-hmm.
And Bogart was very good. But this new actress, Lauren Bacall, I don't think we're going to hear much more from her. She has, her voice is too deep.
Mm-hmm. Jeez.
So it's kind of cute to read that. I mean, sometimes he hits the nail on the head and he loves the good movies and hates the boring ones. But it's interesting to think about, yeah, well, this was the first time people had seen her, and everyone's entitled to their own impression as they leave the theater or tent or whatever. Mm-hmm. But anyway, yeah, you mentioned Lauren Bacall, and I thought, yeah, Dad dismissed her as a flash in the pan after the movie that made her career. So.
Yes. She was strong. She was very hard-headed, but she was, I mean,
tough.
She was a force.
Yeah.
She was a force, you know? Just didn't let up to the end. But so strong, so strong. I love her interview with Cavett. That was one of the funnier ones.
Yeah.
That
yes.
I watched.
And he, you know, he did an Altman film called Health mm-hmm. that no one has seen. I saw it when it came out, but it's never talked about. It's never resuscitated like MASH and Long Goodbye and his other movies.
Yeah.
And James Garner and Lauren Bacall, coincidentally, are in it.
Mm-hmm.
And at the hotel that they were staying at, I think it was somewhere in New England, Bacall asked Cavett to go into her room and bring back her, like, her purse or address book or something like that. So he went up to her room, and her diary was open.
Oh, no, yeah.
And he thought, I cannot pass this up. And he looked, and his eyes landed on, I can't believe what a little shit Dick Cavett is. He thinks he knows everything. He thinks he's funny. And, of course, he felt terrible having seen that. And years later, he was talking to James Garner on the phone, and he brought it up. And Garner started cracking up, and Cavett said, why are you laughing? And he said, Betty and I came up with that idea as a practical joke because we knew you wouldn't be able to resist looking at the diary.
No.
She didn't mean it after all. They got along well as friends. But
wow.
Isn't that a nice little story?
That's incredible.
People don't do practical jokes anymore. It's a shame. It's frowned upon in polite society.
That's the greatest thing I'll probably hear all month. Wow.
I can't believe what a little shit Cavett is. He thinks he knows everything, and he's the funniest guy.
I can just imagine him there reading, you know, and shriveling as he's reading this.
Why did I look at this? Why didn't I just do what you asked me to
haunt
do?
Haunt him for those words haunting him. Jesus. Wow. Well, you've also, we'll start wrapping the episode up, but I do want to touch on the documentaries and the voiceover a little bit. You've also created documentaries, Elvis, John Lennon, Martin Luther King.
Yeah, I was working for a production company that had very limited budget, so we really had to be creative. But I did manage to, one of the things that I was happiest with was stumbling across an extended interview Martin Luther King gave on the Mike Douglas show. It's a weird thing because he's the second guest after Tony Martin, singer and husband of Sid Charisse.
Right.
And so it's like after Tony Martin, oh, and here's Martin Luther King. I guess it was an all Martin show. But it ended up being a very serious conversation, which is good, and it centered on King's disdain for sending black Americans to Vietnam because it wasn't their war, and getting into why they have no quibble with the Vietnamese like they do with white America and blah, 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 blah. And I included that uncut because we had a certain credit on footage of the Mike Douglas show, and a lot of people got to see that for the first time. And I'm glad I was able to include it uncut because it was really, and he would, you know, he was saying things like there's a difference between disloyal and dissent. And it's like, boy, if we could learn that lesson today where speaking out against the government is not to be slammed down to the ground, but cherished as part of freedom. So that was interesting. And yeah, I've done voiceover work. I did some Peanuts cartoons and I've done radio work. And I actually, in addition to doing some voice work, co-wrote an episode of one of the Charlie Brown specials. You're in the Super Bowl, Charlie Brown. And I have the distinction of being the only person that shared a writing credit with Charles Schulz. A friend of mine had worked was working at Bill Melendez Productions where they made the cartoons. And they had finished it, and there were these long stretches where teams of Woodstock birds were playing football. But you couldn't really tell what was going on. It was just music and watching them play football. And I got a call from my friend, and she said, "We're in a bind. We need someone to write narration over this to explain what's going on because it doesn't make any sense." And I had to sit with a VHS tape and my watch pressing start and rewind and stop to make sure it was the right time to see, and I wrote this whole play-by-play sports announcer thing, and then would play it and time it, and it seemed like that would fit. And this is totally the reverse of the way you do animation. You always record the voices first, and then they animate to that. But they hadn't realized that they would have this weird minutes of what the hell's going on. And so I made up what the teams were called. I gave one team member, the names of all the team members were presidents. Jackson throws it to Wilson, and Johnson intercepts. And I kind of bailed them out on that. And but I ended up, she took a, I had a first edition of Snoopy and the Red Baron. And my friend kept it for when Schulz came down from Northern California, and he inscribed it for me and drew a Snoopy. So that's a real prize.
Incredible. I've had Brad Keston, who did some of the specials, the Peanut specials, as the voice of Charlie Brown on. And he's talked about Charles Schulz a little bit, and wow, he just seemed like an amazing human, but you know, he created that whole universe from a comic strip, and that's just amazing.
He did. And then Bill Melendez was a great guy. He was, you know, one of the things I found at Groucho's was that the guys who were true legends had absolutely no ego problems and were very down to earth and approachable. And the people that came over to Groucho's who were part of the new young Hollywood were the ones that had the attitude problems. And Bill Melendez, I mean, he worked at Disney in the 30s and 40s, and then Warner Brothers in the 40s and 50s. I mean, these are the classic periods for all of those studios, and then started his own studio. And the Charlie Brown Christmas was not supposed to be the first of many. It was going to be just a one-shot deal. As a matter of fact, the animation cells don't have a production number. They just have 1, 2, 3, 4, because there was no need to differentiate it from others because there never was one. And that's what started the whole Peanuts specials thing, was that marvelous Christmas show. But Bill was just a great guy to sit down and talk with. He just loved, he had so many stories about, you know, the strike against Disney and the people he worked with and all this stuff. And then he was the voice of Snoopy. Mm-hmm. So he was a great guy. I miss him.
It's just what incredible people have you know, created and really developed that. And I mean, it's just synonymous with our culture now. You know, it's not going anywhere. That's for sure.
It's good.
It's so ingrained. You know, it's just amazing.
I actually exchanged letters with Dr. Seuss, and it was so strange to see his return address because it felt like getting a letter from Santa Claus. Mm-hmm. You know, the fact that he existed in three dimensions.
Yeah, like a real human.
But I had, there was a story in the paper at the time of a school in Northern California that had banned the Lorax because it was a logging town and kids were going home and saying, how come Daddy displaces all of these animals when he goes to work? And they decided that rather than explaining them, they would ban the Lorax from the school library. And I was so pissed. Yeah. And I wrote a letter to Seuss and I said, I assume you are equally annoyed with this. I said, what's going to come next? They'll get rid of How the Grinch Stole Christmas because it isn't a multi-denominational look at the holiday season. Mm-hmm. And they'll get rid of green eggs and ham because of cholesterol. Right. And he wrote me back, and his stationery had a pre-printed Cat in the Hat on it, but he drew a word balloon coming out of his mouth, and he wrote, I'm a dirty old cat who should be expunged from the schoolhouse. And then he said, thank you, Steve, for a wonderfully refreshing letter.
That's
so
great.
That was just so cool that
that's very
these
touching.
People
yeah.
existed in three dimensions.
Absolutely.
Anyway.
Absolutely. I could talk all day, but we have two final questions. One of them you might find interesting.
And the other's dull?
Yes, the other's dull. Dull and boring.
Okay.
So if you could be any character from The Wizard of Oz, who would you be?
Wow. You know, I wasn't thinking that that's what you were going to ask. You know, the witch had the power. The others were flawed. Boy, I guess I'll go with the witch.
The witch? Okay. Got it. Okay. And then, advice to aspiring authors, writers, documentarians.
Invite two of them?
Advice to any aspiring authors or writers or
Oh, advice. I thought you said invite.
Oh, no, that's
and
okay.
And I thought, I'm waiting to hear. I thought you were going to say if you could have lunch with two writers or documentarians, and I'm waiting for the rest of the question, and then there's just
okay.
magnificent desolation, like on the moon with Aldrin. Advice. Probably don't take anyone's advice, because anyone that tells you they know how to achieve this, all they can really do is tell you their experience. But anyone that says, here's what you have to do, or here's what you need to do, it's only one person's opinion. No matter who they are, it's still one person's opinion or experiences. But just in vague terms, connections have to be made if they don't exist already, so that you're not flying blind. It's good to get to know people. I've never gotten to know anyone because I thought it would advance my career. I find that distasteful,
yes.
Which is probably why I'm not more successful than I am. Because if I had more of the shark in me, I would be going to places and they say, oh, that's a good person to know. But I've always hung out with people that I just enjoyed being with. Connections are eventually important. And then if you're going to be a writer, this may seem obvious, but you should write rather than think you might be a writer or might have that potential. And I always advise people, not to anguish over getting it right the first time. I tell them, barf it all. I actually have a post-it stuck to my computer screen that says, get it all down first and mush it around later. Mm-hmm. And especially with computers, because I, you know, at Universal, I was using a Selectric 2 typewriter. And before computers, you would think, I don't want to add that paragraph. It means I'll have to retype everything from page 7 to the end. It's such a cinch now with deleting and cutting and pasting. Mm-hmm. So don't be hard on yourself. Let the childlike part of you play around with the wording. And then you can always go back and polish that. So don't let that stand in the way of taking that step.
Right.
But above all, don't take anyone's advice.
Exactly. Exactly. We are out of time. Do you want to tell the listeners, though, where they can find your book, documentaries, other work, and information about it?
They can find my book under a loose table leg. No, wait a minute. My book is Raised Eyebrows, My Years Inside Groucho's House, and the Kindle and the audiobook version with me, big surprise, doing all the voices and narrating it are available on Amazon. And if they want to, actually, if they want a copy of the book signed or inscribed to them, they can order it from my website, Steve Stolier, STOLIAR.com. But otherwise, Amazon, on Amazon, not along the Amazon. Mm-hmm. I have a number of people that fly down to the rainforest when they hear that, and I feel very guilty. So, no, either Amazon or my website will fix you up.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for coming on
the podcast. It was my pleasure.
Today.
Thank you for knowing so much. Instead of, I had one person say, which brother was the one that played the harp?
Oh, Jesus.
And they were serious. And I wanted to say, take a wild guess, asswipe. Yeah. But I didn't, because I'm a nice guy.
Do a little bit of research, you know? It's
yeah.
It's one of those
things. You, Kat. It was a pleasure.
You're welcome. And thank you. I had just a great time and a great, great, great discussion. So.
Thank you.
That. I'm looking forward to hearing more about the film, too, as well as I'm sure.
So am I.
Kat Lively here. I hope you enjoyed this episode with my guest, Steve Stoliar. Please do yourself a favor and order a copy of his book, Raised Eyebrows, My Years Inside Groucho Marx's House. It is an absolute must read. As well as if you enjoy this episode, please consider signing up to be a patron for $5 a month. You receive bonus episode, footage, photos, video tours, and so much more, as well as monthly raffle entries. If you go to patreon.com/callingoldhollywood, you will see all of the perks and all of the packages that you have to choose from. Every new subscriber also receives free handmade old Hollywood art from yours truly.